Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Okay. So, I'll just go ahead straight. Oh, okay, back first. Today, we'll be talking about Hacker's Guide to Securing Python Web Applications. And it's just a collection of things I've learned along the way. I've been doing security professionally for 6 years now. So things I've learned along the way during client engagements, pen tests, consulting, and then working for the company I currently work with. Tricks I found out how to break into web applications and how to fix them. So just recommendations from a hacker to a developer. Okay. So I'm Itemi Gojule. I like to identify as a hardware, software, and biohacker. So I started out in a previous life. Yeah, I used to be a developer, developing hardware for hardware. Then later transited to software, and yeah, occasionally do social engineering. So I hack people. I do more of research, reverse engineering. Then because of the nature of my work, I work around web application security, mobile application security, and then currently they found that I know how to do DevOps. They threw DevOps at me, so I do DevOps as well. Then I've called it for OAPS Nigeria, blah blah blah. Now these are just fancy titles, though. As a PSF fellow and a member of Django Software Foundation, all this came along as a result of my contribution to open source communities in Africa. So they just threw this at me. I don't think I deserve it, though. Then I'm a retired jazz musician. Yeah, retired. Work came up and I had to stop playing music. Oh, jazz musicians there. How many hands? One, two, three. Oh, awesome. Maybe we should form a band and play something afterwards. Then I'm a member of NigerSec Force. This is a security community. I manage in Nigeria with my team and just a bunch of guys who like to hack stuff, break stuff. And then we gathered weekends, hack. We've been doing this since 2013 or so. And then we organize a security conference as well and mentor folks getting started in security. So this is just all about me. Okay, so I'd mentioned earlier I'm a colleague of OAPS Nigeria, and OAPS is Open Web Application Security Projects. It's a non-profit organization that stands as a standard for web security generally. So I've come across and built standard secure practices that developers should adhere to when securing web applications. And every year, or it used to be every year initially, but now every 2-3 years, there's always a list of top 10 most common vulnerabilities that developers have faced, and security engineers, researchers, analysts have encountered and found to break web applications with. There's a list of them, 10 of them. So this is just a list. We have injection, broken authentication, sensitive data exposure, XML external entities, broken access control, and this is all the list. So basically what I'm talking about are these vulnerabilities, how as a hacker, I would take advantage of these vulnerabilities to exploit your web application, and then what I think you should do to fix your web application if you have any of these vulnerabilities in your application. So in no particular order, I'll start with security misconfiguration. Now this is, to me, the most common I see every day. Every day. So for some people, they just want to build the application very fast, and you know, you learn something new today and you want to try it out, or you have a project at hand, you just want to get things done. You just use default configurations, spin up your web application. Or you think this is what should be, but not necessarily it's secure. So we have lots of security misconfiguration, like insecure application settings, settings that would compromise your application and give attacker privileges, or things that an attacker will look for. So for example, default credentials. I think it's been said that the most popular default credential is admin. So let's say early last year, I was just playing around one of these boring weekends and I got access to a router. The router had admin privileges. And checking through the router, I saw it was the major router for an ISP. And this ISP happens to one of the largest in Africa. Now that is for a router. Most people wouldn't even go that far. But for web applications, every day you see a web application, and then the admin privilege, the admin user has admin and password, or admin and I love God as password. Lots of this. So first thing I do, if I'm testing an application and I see a login page, I just run a script that runs a word list of usernames and passwords, common usernames and passwords, against the application, and try to see which of them logs in. So this is the first thing I try when I see a login page. Check for credentials. Unused pages. So when you're building an application, you created a page, but later on you thought, okay, well, let's leave this aside, we'll build something else, and you don't decommission it. So it's still there in your code base. The page is still up. An attacker will look out for things like this and use to exploit your application. So this is a very popular one. When you're writing, say, a Django application, and then you set, so you can see up there, at the top there, your code, you set debug equals to true, and you forget this and ship to production. Yeah, you say, no, I can't do that. But I've seen a bank that built an application and had this in production. As well, I've seen for a government entity that was supposed to manage records of high school, a certificate exam for high school users, high school students, and then the application, major application that managed everybody's registration had something like this as well. And this is a gold mine. So all I need to do as an attacker is to try, so if you see the URL up there, have a debug equals to one. So all I just need to do is whatever URL I can find on the application, the Python application, I append that to it, debug equals to one. And if you left debug equals to true in your code like this up, well, I should get an error message, possibly. Or if you are like me that likes using the WebSocket toolbar, debug toolbar, you will get this. And with this toolbar, you could basically do an undo. So see everything about the configuration file of the application with this. You could see, basically everything here. And then I think in 2016 or 2016-17, Patreon got hacked. And how did the attacker get access? He found this toolbar left in production, debug equals to true. And then, one of the when WebSocket toolbar gives you an error, it gives you an interactive Python shell to debug the application. And this is what the guy did. Simply just used the one-liner to read application files and then copied every single thing. And so user accounts, every single user detail on Patreon, copied and published openly. So this, now I've seen this as well during the pen test, and used this to get access to their server, and from one server was hopping, and then ended the whole pen test in just one day because of this small mistake. Now you say, oh, okay, I just want to test it and see how it looks like, see what error message or what debug message I can get, and you forget to switch from debug equals to true to false in production. So now, very simple, one line of code can make you lose access to your whole server, your application, your user details and credentials, everything. So for Flask, set up the debug equals to false. Simple and fixes it straightforward. Same thing for Django, debug equals to false. So then what I do is, I'm just going to script and come back to it. Yeah, I always have a default settings of py file where I put every configuration I want into. And I make sure to use set this case, if application environment is production, switch debug equals to false. And if environment is development, yeah, it could be true. So this could save you a lot of stress. Okay, then back to this. Do not run debug mode in production. Now, I've been talking just about this debug. There are other things as well. Couple of other things, I mentioned the credentials as well. So for credential, my advice is that the admin user or super admin user
should be disabled. Because most times you will feel, oh, I'm just the only one who knows there's a super user on the application, and then you use a very simple password or a password that is guessable. So best thing is disable the super admin user and then create another user with assigned privileges. Don't run admin publicly. So if you notice, let's see if I can see the URL. Oh, okay, URL is in here though. But most times for the login page, you'll see so login then /admin for some most applications. And then I can tell that the user is an admin. The name of the user is admin. So what is advisable is change your naming convention. So instead of naming admin, name something else. Something that an attacker wouldn't guess or wouldn't give an attacker an insight into what your application, the admin of your application. Okay, so for next one, injection. Now this is another popular vulnerability that affects lots of applications. So we have OS code injection, we have SQL injection, LDAP injection, quite a lot of these injection vulnerabilities. So basically, how does it work? Your application takes in user inputs, right? And this user input is simply incorporated into a command that you could call it a payload. So, incorporated in a command that an attacker could insert a payload into and then run. So, rule of thumb is assume that every user input is untrusted. You're building an application for regular users. But someone like me, I'm not a regular user. So what happens in that case? So you build an application and there's a search bar, let's assume there's a search bar. You expect that normal users would search for a regular query. But I'm not a regular user. The hacker out there that has been paid by your rival is not a regular user. So they would always throw in untrusted user inputs. So what you have to do is sanitize user inputs. Make sure every user input you receive is sanitized. Yeah, this is just a fun fact. The major Sony hack was don't try SQL injection. SQL injection through a search query on one seemingly small application used by Sony, and then the attacker from that application got access to the server, and then started laterally moving through the network, and then got access to all Sony's files. I can't remember the size though, but I know it was massive. Huge amounts of terabytes of data was exposed, and yeah. So this is just a sample code that handles file upload for a Python web application. And if you see here where the file upload is being done, the user input is not properly sanitized there. And so as an attacker, what I can do is, so let's say you're expecting what kind of file, so let's say, okay, you're a job recruitment agency, or you're a developer for a job recruitment agency, and you build the application, and you said, okay, so I know attackers could upload malicious files, so let me just restrict it to just PDFs and Word documents. Smart, but for me, since I know that, or I found out that your application does not sanitize user inputs, what I just need to do is change the file name. So it will still be .png, but I would make my payload the file name. And for this particular application, we got my team, we got from this unsanitized inputs vulnerability led to SQL, and from SQL, we're able to do code injection. And once I have code injection, if I can run any single command on your application, I've owned your server. So always, 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 always validate and sanitize user inputs. You can't say enough of it. Always, your attacker is not a normal user that would use normal inputs, expected inputs, give expected inputs. So always sanitize inputs. Okay, I'll just say this. So there was this particular application we're testing, and for 2 months we were on these engagements. We couldn't get anything, 2 months. And an intern on our team decided to try logging into the application. And in place of the username, entered admin, admin, a quote, space, asterisk, and slash. And that broke the application. And it bypassed the login. That was all. So your user, your attacker out there is not a regular user that would give you expected inputs. So always, always sanitize your inputs. Then for Django, instead of having to execute raw SQL in your application, use Django ORMs. It saves you a lot of stress. Pretty straightforward. And some people would advise you should use SQL Academy, so you don't have to write raw SQL queries. But whatever fixes, whatever works for you best, but just do not write raw SQL queries in your application. Next one up is broken access control. Now, you've created the application, you know well to authenticate users properly, but are you to authorize users properly to use the application, but are you authenticating them properly? So I have let's say, I'm thinking of a perfect example to use. Can anyone suggest an example of an application that has segments authentication for users? Okay, I'll go with something simple. So let's say we have this web application. Users log in, just a social media app, upload their profile pictures, what they like, and all that, and say maybe even personal chat. They could DM each other chats. But then, as an attacker, I create an account as well. I get authenticated into the application, and then decide to play around. This was a first in 2015. They had a simple URL that had URL / videos / numbers. So the numbers were recorded sessions for every call you made. So something like you have Zoom now. Every single call you make, there's a recorded session of the video uploaded to their server. But then it was saved with an incrementing number. So as an attacker, all I need to do is just change the last digits and put a new digit. So for example, if it's 735, I could change, delete 5 and make it 736. And I get access to a new video. Same thing works for user accounts. So you could just change the last digits, give access to a new user. A crypto trading platform that I used to use, I had to stop using them because of that. You could simply see every user's profile, see the amount they've traded, the amount they had as balance, with something as simple as this. All you had to do was guess the user's name. So in the URL, once you log in the URL, it shows your name, your username in the URL. All I had to do as an attacker was to guess someone else's name and put it in the URL, and to bring out the person's profile. Now, you tried to stop people, you've provided nice authentication method around your application that stops people from breaking in. But what happens to people that are already in the application? Legitimate users. Now, this is what happens in that scenario. So this is an example. We have an action that is to be called on for this page. Happy, and it loads the page, fine, works well. But what happens if I change happy to something else? So in this case, admin. Now I'm admin. I was happy before as a regular user, now I'm admin. So this happens a lot of time. Just a simple mistake. So yeah, why should you make that kind of mistake? How to fix this is make sure you assign session cookies to each user. So each user has a unique session ID that terminates immediately after session after logout or yeah. Same thing with JWT tokens. We're using JWT tokens. Enforce session timeouts on each tokens log, and then the tokens are tied to a particular user. So as a user, I can't access another user's profile. As a user, I can't perform an action that another user should be able to perform because I don't have that privilege. Then, yeah, so user-to-user session for indirect objects references. If you're referencing an object tied to a user action, use a user-to-user session for that. Then URL design as well. The way you design your URLs for your application, that should be something you should consider as well. So like again, I would say, when designing your URL, don't make it easy for a user. Now, you're designing the application for the user to use, not the URL itself for the user to use. So it's the application user is supposed to be focused on, not the URL. So you could modify the URL to something that is only understandable by you and your team, but not the user. So the user can't manipulate URL parameters. What else? Okay, authentication. How authentication is implemented is very, very critical to your application. And another fun fact, user credentials stored without proper encryption. So an attacker could guess the user credential. Also, session IDs. If session IDs are not properly enforced, so let's say, for example, you have your application. Now, user logs in successfully, has a session ID, but the session ID is not properly enforced. That's a timeout, or your user performs an action. And for an action that requires higher privilege, the user still performs same action with same session ID. That's wrong. So you should enforce use lockdown views. Django implements that, has a permission architecture that allows you to use lockdown views. So for every action performed by a user, every action that requires authentication, you enforce authentication for that action. So for example, as a user, let's say I log in as a bank user and I want to transfer money from when I get to the part where I have to perform an action that requires transferring cash, making transfer or withdrawal, you enforce authorization again. For Flask has, I think, the plugin for Flask called Flask Login that handles that as well. So, like I tell people, there's already a plugin that does that in the ecosystem. Why go ahead building for yourself? Your own implementation might just be vulnerable. Then for Django query sets, you could customize it to perform an object lookup that involves object ownership. So each object is tied to an owner. In that way, nothing goes wrong. This is gold. So components that have known vulnerabilities. You build the application using Django 1.8. Current version of Django, I think 2.2, 2.3 right now. When you built it with Django 1.8, it was pretty fine, worked well, no issues whatsoever, you're on top of your security game. But now, researchers found vulnerabilities in Django 1.8, and if Django itself has moved up to 2.something, you're still on 1.8. As an attacker, if I were to profile your application, first thing I would do is to run your application through something like BuildTweet. BuildTweet would tell me, BuildTweet.com. So to give me a profile of what your application is built with, the technologies used. Another thing is for me to just simply use a vulnerability scanner to run against your application, and to give me at least a profile of your application, what it's built with. Next thing I do logically is to go on ExploitDB. So ExploitDB is a website that curates publicly known exploits, and I check for an exploit against that particular version number. So these are top 10 vulnerabilities for Django. Session hijacking, that was in 2014. They are tagged with CVEs, common vulnerability and exploits, and the number. So it's kind of like the official names for those vulnerabilities. Now, if you see that, 2014 is the year the vulnerability was discovered or officially reported. And you find applications still vulnerable to vulnerabilities with these version numbers. So what happens in that case? And as an attacker, I find the application runs on a lower version than the current version existing. I check ExploitDB. I see a publicly available exploit for it. Wow. Anybody can go on GitHub and download that exploit or ExploitDB. And most of these exploits, they just require no skill at all to run. Just so, for example, Python exploits.py. And then maybe pass as an argument the IP address. That's all required to run most of these exploits. And any 12, 13, 14-year-old kid with little experience of how Python works hits at your application, and he has access to your application, or maybe your server itself, take over the whole server, access to your customer records. So my advice to people, this is still a list of the exploits, publicly known exploits against Django, most common of them, patch. So if your application is running, except except it's a legacy application that you do not want to, you explicitly do not want to patch. The advice is to patch. So you're like, how many patches do I have to make? All of them as possible, but try as much as possible not to break your build. But every vulnerability, every component you have in your application should be on the latest version. That is the most advisable thing to do. Because vulnerabilities have been discovered, you're yet to patch, attackers would always exploit them. They count on the fact that if you are using a lower version of an application, there's a likelihood that you'll be vulnerable to a lot of other things. If you've not taken due diligence to fix, to upgrade your application, your component from the version it is currently to the existing version, there is a very high possibility that you'd have made mistakes with other things like configuration, code mistakes, and all that. So they take leverage of all these things and then go ahead to exploit. So what I say, patch. Patch everything. Now, this cross-site scripting, to most people, I can't be vulnerable to this. Why? I use Django, I use Flask, they've already implemented security that addresses all this. My application is on the latest version, so yeah, I'm fine. But cross-site scripting exists, even in the most seemingly secure applications. And what cross-site scripting? Cross-site scripting basically is when an attacker can make calls to, say, JavaScript code in your application. Like I explained initially, user inputs that connect to a command. So it could be on the base level an OS command. And then you accept these user inputs into your application, into your database, untrusted. An attacker could leverage on that and then say call JavaScript, even call basically any code that can run via the browser, and then get your application to perform unauthorized actions, perform unintended actions. So basically, how it works is, say I have a login form field or a search bar, and then you enter into this field user inputs. You're expecting user to enter, say, comments or name, but then you still do not sanitize inputs. What happens is a user could just simply pass JavaScript query code, one line JavaScript code that interacts with the browser through the browser with the application, and then gets it to do the unintended. Okay, so lots of people get hacked every day with XSS. That's why I say even the most seemingly secure applications get hacked with XSS. Well, now, simple fixes to XSS will be to simple sanitize all user inputs. Same thing again. About 4 of these vulnerabilities on the top 10, OWASP's top 10, can be solved by just sanitizing user inputs. Making sure you sanitize, like I say, no user is to be trusted. You build in mind that you have a regular user, a user that will do what is intended. But then your attacker is not your intended user. So sanitize all inputs. With Flask, you could use Jinja to escape these user inputs. So I have something like this here for Jinja. So simple, if you're taking user inputs that is reflected through a URL, all you need to do is to pass it through the E and sanitize the input. Simple. Or you could use Jinja utils. So that's just a quick way around that. And you see, if you notice, the output of the supposedly XSS payload comes out garbled like this, URL encoded. And you're fine. Also, make sure to quote your attributes with either double or single quotes. So if you have where you require attributes in your code, for example, where we have URL there, always encode it in single or double quotes. So it's interpreted as a comment. And then once a user passes input, whatever the input user passes is interpreted as a comment. And then it's not interpreted as a payload or as a command. And you're fine. Next one is sensitive data exposure. Now you build your application, you ship, and in a bid to hit market demand, you do not really build to handle exposure of data. a lot of things could be termed as sensitive. You have financial data, your user data, personal details, date of birth, so health records, and all that. This information could fall into the wrong hands. So when you're building your application, and what you have in mind is whatever it's you regard as sensitive information for that particular application should be well secured. So for example, if you're taking in user credentials, make sure to encrypt. Most people would use MD5 and feel that secure for passwords. MD5 isn't. It's just a hash. It's not an encryption scheme. So encode, encrypt, the two E's, encode, encrypt. And yeah, so basically that should handle most of issues around sensitive data exposure. So your customer details should be encoded during transmission, encrypted during transmission and encoded for storage. Next we have XML external entities. So XML basically is a data format that you use to describe data basically. So handle that data transmission simply. And as an attacker, what you intended for it was just to handle data. So, but for me, I can use it to pull data off your system, like say, read local files. I have an example here. So if you see the URL, please, in the URL, the URL is intended just to read an XML file, simple XML file, or load an XML resource. When as an attacker, I could write a simple XML script in the URL, and then in this case, I use it to read the slash /etc/password file of this system of my local machine. Now, this is just a local exploit. Now, there are also as well remote exploits that an attacker could use to read an external file from a malicious website and redirect your users to the malicious site one, or load that malicious payload to your users. And in a way, you're serving, so you end up serving malware to your users without knowing. So this was supposed to be, can you see this please? Oh, okay. I don't know why it's not clear. It's supposed to be a demo video of me trying to exploit an application that was loading an XML file. Okay, so simply I just, in the browser, if you notice it showed roots, when I tried using a simple XML tag, and then it showed me that it was vulnerable to XML injection, and then I proceeded to use this payload to read the file. Now, this is just the /etc/password file. I could use to read other files on the system. I could as well use it to upload a file to the system. This is just reach. I could use it to write a file to the system as well. And then install a backdoor on the system through this simple payload. Now, this is one of the most favorite for me. Thing is, so most people do not regard this as really a vulnerability, but I think it is. Why? An attacker tries to brute force your application. I didn't talk about this. A fix for this would be to sanitize input as well. So you see, sanitizing user inputs fixes a lot of these things. Simple. That just fixes it. Sanitize user inputs. Handles every problem around this. So back to login and monitoring. Now you built your application, works fine. Works perfectly fine. You fix every other vulnerability possibly inherent to your application. But then you do not have monitoring enabled for your application. So for example, error messages are not appropriately logged. If there's an exception in your application, it doesn't catch the error messages and saves to a log. And so what happens is, as an attacker, if I'm trying to brute force your application, and I notice that there's no error messaging being logged, what I'll do is I know you're not properly monitoring your application. So what happens is that it gives me more room to try other things, a lot of other things. But if I know you're monitoring the all attempts to break into the application, what that tells an attacker is, oh, this person is properly serious about security. And so a person either gives up or takes steps backward. But then when I find out that you're not monitoring your application, it gives me room to. So it's not exactly technically seen as a vulnerability, but it's a logical vulnerability, yeah. So simple lack of monitoring, an attacker leverages on that, exploits the application before they detected, and then say implant a backdoor in your server, or do lateral movements on your server, and then get the end goal. So like I said, logging is used just for identifying attacks in progress. Sometimes it could be that you've already been compromised, you've already been attacked. Having an efficient log mechanism in place would help you to tell what happened, what the attacker did, and how to prevent it happening in the future. Yeah, and this, I just have this here for people who want to say, okay, I fixed every other thing, but I want to see how far, how secure I am. These are some off-the-shelf tools from GitHub you could just pick and try. Python Taints, Bandits, Mona.py, and Spaghetti Security. So Spaghetti was actually intended for just the code smells, but later on they threw in security to it, so it checks for security vulnerabilities, most security vulnerabilities as well. And then you could just, this one is just say a do-it-yourself, the do-it-yourself scanners you could use. Well, so thank you very, very much. Please don't ask any questions.
Yeah, first of all, thanks a lot. Can you switch the previous slide back, because I saw somebody tried to
sorry.
Yeah, to shot to make a photo and okay, questions. How many issues you found for the in this year, for example, in the
this year? Okay. Now, most of them are not Python related though.
Okay.
Fine, let's talk about them. Okay. So one of the largest payment gateways in, or payment processors in Africa. Okay, first thing there is Shodan. Shodan is the Google for Internet of Things, any internet connected device, Shodan.io. So what I do is, if I have a target, in mind, I just go there, search the name of the target, or use some special queries and see all their connected devices on the internet. So servers, routers, everything, yeah. And so for these guys, I just decided to check, saw a lot of their servers, production, staging servers, and I tried. So like I said, the first thing I try is default credentials. For their staging server, I got in with admin. And then I saw a WAF file, so their Java shop, I saw a WAF file that pushes directly to production. And I could edit that. And like I said, it's a payment processor, so on the average, they do say between between $2 to $7 million transactions per day. That's on the average. So I could say move something in that range, yeah, and I'll be set up for life. That's one. Which other? Okay, another one again. They're using Apache. Like I say, most of them are not Python related though. This one, they're using Apache. The version of Apache they're using was, I think it was a 3.4 or so. Way that's like 2 years beneath the current version. And on ExploitsDB, on GitHub, there are a lot of vulnerabilities that exploits that particular Apache version. So I just checked for them, picked one of them and tried against the server, and simple. I just ran Python, Python, the name of the exploits, and then the IP address and the port number I was targeting. And that was all. I got access to it. Which other one comes to mind? Let's see. Just XML entity. This one, I was doing a pen test for one of the largest organizations in Europe, say some months ago, and I found one of the applications vulnerable to XML entities. And with that, I was able to exploit their developer environments. Which other, let's see, sensitive data exposure. This one, okay, this one had to do with AWS for another payments organization. They exposed AWS buckets, which happens sometimes mistakenly, but then on the buckets they had user credentials which were not encrypted. So it has happened, I think Twitter, early this year, they had a leak like that they had exposed buckets, and an attacker got access to user credentials, but they were all encrypted. So till date, nobody has been able to break that encryption, which works fine. So, like I said, sensitive data should be encrypted and or encoded. XSS, yeah. This was last year. I bought a flight for less than $1 with an XSS vulnerability. A return ticket. Which other? Broken authentication, nothing. I don't think I found anything around this year. This was a pen test as well I was doing, and then we just simply needed to switch user privileges. So I already knew, I'd already done a profiling of who the admin of the application was. I knew his first name, his last name. And I saw that when I created an account, a user account, my name was what was in the URL there. So I just put in the admin's first name, and I had access. So just one thing I should say, for people who do bug bounties, they find out that the most critical bugs they find are after they've gotten authenticated session already. So they create a legitimate user account and they've been logged in. That's when they find the most critical vulnerabilities. I think that's for the same one. A friend, now not me, last year got a huge bug bounty with Uber, and they gave him a year's ride for free with this same vulnerability last year. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Questions? Yeah.
Thank you for the speech. There was a slide with an anchor tag.
With what?
There was a slide with an anchor tag, and the URL was in the quotation marks and without. What's the threat here?
Which, I didn't here?
No. A slide with an anchor tag, a tag, HTML.
Let's see, XSS.
This one. What's the threat here? So I pass the URL without the quotation marks and with the quotation marks. This is template. This is backend template rendering.
Yeah.
What could go wrong?
So now here, the URL in this case is an attribute. It could be rendered as anything, as a command. So there is an injection called SSTI, server side template injection, XSS. They look alike. But are not alike. But both of them use this method. So there's an attribute. Since the attributes are rendered as commands, as instructions, as actions, a user could pass in a payload that causes an action to be acted on or interpreted. So if you enclose it in quotes, it's interpreted as a comment. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Hello.
Hi.
My question is, do you use your skills to hack internet sites for your needs?
To hack what?
Internet sites.
Yeah. For what?
For your needs.
I didn't get the last word.
For your need.
For my needs?
Yeah.
So that was in a former life. At least for the past 6 years, I haven't. Yeah. The one I said I bought a flight, I didn't go on a trip. Yeah. I just found it and then reported to the organization. Yeah. So I don't personally know. I haven't. For my life, yes. That's say 7-8 years ago, yes.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hello. Sorry for my English.
That's
about,
fine.
This site, maybe you need to use template formatter to sanitize this URL instead quotas.
Yes, but I didn't get it.
The question is maybe it's better not to use the only quotes, but to use a template sanitizer,
yes.
Like escaping the template. Yeah.
And about SQL, previous slides.
SQL injection, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. Previous.
Previous.
Previous. Oh. Yeah.
Okay. If you use params in core execute, you have to sanitize by library.
Library, yeah.
By lab. By yeah. Library. And last questions about NoSQL injection.
Okay.
Injections. It's injections with same type of with SQL injections. And how about combine this injections in the new presentations?
Okay, so NoSQL injection, I think for the past 2-3 years, I don't think I've even come across any application that was vulnerable to NoSQL injection. So it's a pretty more advanced case, even way advanced than blind SQL injection, which is rarely seen. So in case of NoSQL injection, depending on what...
Same type of injections with point for existing for context. Sorry, it's English mode. You scroll in the text and now no scroll in the
text.
It's an analogous type.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. The question was, what do you think about the using the mechanism of SQL injection when you're actually going out of the context of the request to the database and doing the stuff you need? For example, you can write the SQL injection that write data from the database to CSV file to the to the public available folder. Okay. And with the NoSQL, do you find some injections for the NoSQL databases like Redis and
okay. So there are ways to exploit NoSQL databases. Yes, but like I said, none are found in recent times. Yeah.
Yeah, but there is a so type of injections.
Yes, people have found and reported NoSQL injections. Yes.
Yeah.
But for the past 2-3 years, I haven't found personally.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Anything else?
Is that all for questions?
Yeah. Well, I just want to say that a couple of years ago I made the. Also the speech about the security, and one of the most common thing I'm find and see and still find it every time when people using cloud computing like DigitalOcean, Amazon Web Services, they starting the node and never update it. And you're just logging and see the message from the operating system that there is a 300 of updates and 100 of them are security updates. And yeah, it's a real problem. So if you have cloud computing nodes, try to keep them up to date also because it's a real problem.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. So thank you very much.
So if you want to troll me on Twitter.
And you need to choose the best question.
Best question.
Yeah.
I would have chosen you, but no.
Except me.
I was asked a question. I can really remember two people there.
What was this about? It was about URL?
Yep. URL, yes.
Yeah.
He asked about URL, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So if you want to troll me on Twitter, that's my handle. And if you want to spam me, that's my email address. Please don't send phishing links. I don't get links. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.